Over the last few years, I've dropped many cameras on remote reefs in the Indo-Pacific and recorded some fantastic creatures on my hit list. But I've always been limited to the depths I can dive to. Today, that changes. No one has explored these deep pockets of the Bali Sea before, and you will not believe what we found. Okay, so today is the day, super exciting, because this thing here has been about 6 months in the making, and basically it enables us to get the cameras down way deeper to like 200 or 300 meters maybe. Plan is, we're gonna drop it down here first for a test run. If that works well, we'll punch it out super deep and find some deeper water. But my goal for today is to try and find a species that I've never recorded before. In theory, this should be pretty simple. The camera, bait and light is attached to the metal frame that's loaded with weight to help it sit firmly on the bottom. We'll lower the structure down on a rope, give it a little bit of slack, and then clip a couple of floats to it to act as a visual surface marker. However, past 100 meters, the pressure is immense, and strong currents tear across the ocean floor. And things don't always go according to plan. The first thing that became very clear down at 100 meters is that it's almost completely pitch black. Very little visible light is able to penetrate this deep, as it's absorbed and scattered by water molecules and particles in the surface layers. But this presents an opportunity to record species that I have never seen before, ones especially adapted to living in the darkness. And it didn't take long for the first new species to approach the camera. I believe this is a crimson jobfish. However, the biggest issue with dropping cameras this deep is currents, and shortly after getting the camera down, the currents picked the line up and pulled the camera off the bottom into deeper water. Although, we did manage to record a pair of cuttlefish as it drifted across the reef. We were going to need much more weight. The plan for the day was to scope out a number of different spots along the coastline. These areas are completely unexplored, and nobody knows what lives in the deep. We wanted to try rocky sites, sandy sites, protected sites, and exposed sites, and ultimately get it down to the deepest pockets we could find in search of a new species. Although, after pulling the structure back up from the first drop site, it became clear that this was going to be a long day. Drop 2 was an 80-meter drop next to a rocky headland that extends out from the beach. Now, whilst I've heard many stories of hammerheads and other big sharks cruising in the depths here, unfortunately, drop 2 was not successful. And other than a few shadows passing by in the distance, we didn't get much action. However, on drop 3, we decided to strap another fish to the top of the bait cage to act as a visual lure. And after a cautious approach from a pair of unicorn leather jackets, we managed to draw in the first predator. This is a starry triggerfish, a species of trigger that prefers moderately deep waters. Despite other fish species keeping their distance, these starry triggers are aggressive and territorial, and this individual soon got to work tearing apart the fish attached to the cage. He was also accompanied by a large mixed school of jacks and trevallies, including a large golden trevally. Whilst the smaller trevallies weren't confident enough to approach the camera, they made sure to pick off any scraps the triggerfish missed. On drop 4, we dropped the camera on another deep sandy bay, and soon after it hit the bottom, a big long-faced emperor came in for a closer look, shortly followed by a big school of unicorn fish. However, unlike the large long-faced emperor that kept its distance, these smaller emperors were happy coming much closer, and were quick to pick away at the fish on top of the cage. For drop 5, we moved the camera much deeper in the bay. Whilst these sandy bays can look barren and devoid of life, many critters live under the sand, and it didn't take long for several fireworms to detect the scent of the fish and move in to feed. These are dark-lined fireworms, a species of polychaete worm armed with hundreds of fluorescent venomous spines. Unfortunately for them though, they weren't quite tall enough to reach the fish. However, whilst we can mitigate issues caused by current, pressure and light, some things can't be controlled. And not long after dropping camera 5, this happened. Yep, there's even trash down at these depths. But despite the bag completely ruining the presentation of the bait, something very unexpected soon swam past. But more on that later. So far, whilst we'd managed to record a whole host of different species, including multiple species I've never seen before, we hadn't managed to find the dark pockets of deep reef. However, on day two, that all changed, and nothing could have prepared me for what approached the camera later that day. Now, one thing I was concerned about when dropping these cameras was whether certain species were being deterred by the light. The shallower waters in this area are regularly dived, and I wondered if these larger fish were fearful of torches. However, due to an equipment malfunction on drop 6, we accidentally put this theory to the test. Due to clear conditions that morning, we were lucky that we still had some light down at 90 meters. A few dark shadows soon swam past in the distance, possibly reef sharks finishing up a night of hunting. But shortly after, another very large predator emerged from the blue. This is a giant trevally, one of the largest trevally species in the entire ocean. These fish are known for their insane strength and aggression, and whilst they're sometimes found at depth, recording one down at 90 meters is rather unusual. However, whilst giant trevallies prefer to chase their prey rather than scavenge, other large ocean predators aren't quite as picky. This is a two-spot red snapper, and these snappers are the reason why I don't typically attach fish to the outside of the bait cages. Because after swimming around the cage a few times, this happened. The snapper and GT stayed close to the camera for the remainder of the drop, and I was starting to think that my theory of shallower water predators being fearful of light was correct. But we were going to need to do some further tests. On drop 7, we recorded a pair of wahoo on the way down to 100 meters. These pelagic predators are the fastest fish in the ocean, but they prefer to chase fast-moving prey, so I'm not sure they were particularly interested in following 20 kilos of steel down to the ocean floor. Shortly after hitting the bottom, a large school of pickhandle barracuda swam past, but despite being known to scavenge, they showed little interest in the bait. However, like on drop 5, sometimes it's important to zoom in a little, and it wasn't long before another smaller bottom-dwelling predator emerged from the sand. This is the first time I've recorded an octopus on a baited camera, although it soon became clear that this small octopus was much more interested in trying to catch the small sand perch that was swimming around the bait cage. On drop 8, with a bright midday sun, I decided to try a second drop with no light. However, after dropping it down to 90 meters and recording multiple snappers keeping their distance, it seemed that perhaps the light wasn't the problem. However, shortly afterwards, something very unexpected emerged from behind the rocks. This is a much better recording of the creature we recorded on drop 5, an olive ridley turtle. And not only have I never seen one before whilst diving, I've never recorded one on a baited camera before. These turtles can be identified by their dark eyes and flatter shells that are in stark contrast to the characteristics of the more common green and hawksbill turtles in this area. However, what's really cool about this encounter is turtles are air breathers, and this one is down at 90 meters on a single breath. Olive ridleys dive to these depths to forage for jellyfish and crustaceans, and can hold their breath for up to half an hour when performing routine activities. It's possible that the scent from the bait made this one come in for a closer look, although after a few laps, it swam off into the blue. Whilst drop 8 didn't result in any more new finds, a few common species swam past the camera, like this bluefin trevally, as well as a longfin bannerfish that decided to pick at the bait, accompanied by a yellow-lined snapper that tried, albeit unsuccessfully, to get in on the action. However, the mission was to drop these cameras to the bottom of the Bali Sea, to the deepest pockets of water we could find in the local area. For the final two drops, we worked up the courage to go much deeper, and it did not disappoint. Down at 150 meters, the ocean floor looks completely different. With almost no light reaching these depths, and the pressure being 15 times what it is at the surface, only the hardiest of creatures can survive. Shallower water corals don't grow down here, and instead the ocean floor is covered in whip corals, sea fans and sponges that can tolerate the extreme conditions. However, this area certainly wasn't devoid of fish life, and as soon as the camera hit the bottom, it was surrounded by a huge mixed school of jobfish and breams. It seemed, down at these depths, where the fish are unaware of the diving activity nearer the surface, that artificial light is definitely not a problem. However, despite an abundance of smaller fish species, much bigger predators also patrol these depths. This is an enormous dog-toothed tuna, and is probably nearing a meter and a half long. The smaller breams continue to show interest in the bait, showing off their remarkable ability to hover completely motionless in the water column, despite strong currents. But at these depths, food is hard to come by, and if you don't make the most of an opportunity when it arises, there are many more aggressive predators waiting in line that won't turn away an easy meal. This is a deep water moray eel, and this one is hungry. Moray eels ball up around their prey to secure it, and they have incredibly powerful jaws. They can also swallow very large prey whole. Now, this moray appears to be a hyphen moray, characterized by its color pattern and shape. However, these morays supposedly reside in shallow reefs down to a maximum depth of 20 meters, so recording this one swimming around down at 120 meters is incredibly interesting. It's possible that this is the first time this species has been recorded so deep, and represents a significant increase in their depth distribution. It's very possible that if we continue to drop cameras down at these depths, and deeper, we'll record lots of behavior that's new to science. But morays aren't the only large predators that hunt down here. This is another new species for me, a longfin yellowtail or almaco jack. And whilst these fish are known to hunt in deeper water, this one is hunting well below its typical range. Now, when setting out on this mission, I had no idea what we'd find down at these depths. After all, nobody has ever explored this deep before in the area. Whilst I was hoping for lots of action, there was always a possibility we'd record absolutely nothing. However, after drop 9, it seemed clear that going deeper was the key. The 50 to 100 meter range was still occupied by shallow water fish that were wary of lights and cameras. But beyond 100 meters, things were different. However, nothing could have prepared me for what we were going to record on drop 10. Beyond 100 meters, lots of creatures have adapted to blend into the malleable whip corals, fans, and sponges, like this deep water pipefish. These seahorse relatives drift along the seabed, imitating whip corals, seagrasses, and debris, and even when disturbed, they rarely give away their cover. Down at 150 meters, the seabed is covered in small invertebrates, like these small orange crustaceans that jump along the sand. Given the way they propel themselves, I wonder if these are a species of deep-sea squat lobster. Now, whilst drop 10 didn't have as much fish life as the previous drop, a pair of large jobfish circled the bait for the majority of the drop, trying to pluck up the courage to come closer. Over the course of the last 2 days, we recorded over 10 hours of footage for this video, and in typical fashion, we had to wait till the last 10 minutes to be rewarded. This deep-sea shelled creature is a nautilus, a cephalopod closely related to other mollusks like octopus, squid, and cuttlefish. Nautilus are often referred to as living fossils, with an ancient lineage dating back over 500 million years, surviving unchanged for much of this time. Unlike other cephalopods, nautiluses have relatively primitive eyesight, lacking lenses, and instead rely on a pinhole camera-type structure. They use chemoreception to detect their prey, making use of sensory organs inside their siphon and tentacles to find decaying organic matter on the ocean floor. And they have lots of tentacles. This one must have felt like it had hit the jackpot and spent around 20 minutes probing around inside the bait cage. Due to overfishing and habitat loss, and the fact that they rarely venture shallower than 100 meters, this sighting is incredibly rare, and is perhaps the rarest creature I've ever recorded on a baited camera. Needless to say, we'll be dropping cameras down deep again, and next time we'll be going much deeper. My goal with this series is to find a species new to science. Subscribe if you want to see what we find next.